Good morning.
Good morning.
Our speaker today is James Draeger. He's author of Together,
Bottoms Up.
Good job. A toast to Wisconsin historic bar and breweries, beer and bar industry in Wisconsin. Jim is an architectural historian with the State Historic Preservation Office at the Wisconsin Historical Society, with more than 29 years in historic preservation experience. From roadside architecture to Northwood resorts, Draeger celebrates the importance of ordinary buildings to daily lives through his research, writing, and lecture. Please give a warm welcome to our speaker, Jim Draeger.
Thank you, Julie. You know, what I love about northern Wisconsin is that little thing called weather doesn't keep people down. You know, a couple of years ago, I went to Green Bay and gave a talk at the Neville Public Museum. It was 30 degrees below zero, and they packed the auditorium. And I said it was the history version of the ice bowl, you know. I knew I was in northern Wisconsin this morning when I came to, I ate at the deli downtown, and when I pulled up, somebody's car was parked on the curb running. And I thought, you know, you don't see that in Madison for some reason. People don't leave their car running with the doors open. I don't know why that is. Okay, so we'll just go into the first slide here, if we can get that up. Oh, there we go. Okay, so start with a confession. I didn't intend to write a book about Wisconsin taverns and breweries. It happened accidentally in a really strange way. I had written a book with my co-author Mark Speltz called Filler Up, which is a history of gas stations in Wisconsin. I think it's really fascinating because the gas station to me is one of the most interesting of all buildings because it's something that everyone has a shared experience with. Anybody here not been to a gas station? Right? And there are not a lot of buildings you can say that about. It's a background building that's part of everybody's life and nobody gives it a second thought. So Mark and I did that. We gave a second thought to gas stations. We talked about the place that they hold in culture and really why they're important. And as we were, that book came out, and as we were traveling around the state doing events related to it, we were joking all the way along about other books that we could write that would have up in the title. And ironically, it turns out we end up writing another book together, and we joked about the title. We called it Bottoms Up just as a joke, and then when it came time to select the title, I sent about 35 different titles to the press for consideration, and they picked Bottoms Up, and we laughed really heartily about that. We thought that was pretty funny. Okay, so great, great image. You know, I agreed to do the book, and about a week later, my boss walked down the hallway, and he handed me this map, and he said, I found this map on the internet, and I thought you might find it interesting. And what I love about showing this is people laugh before I can explain what the map is, because it seems pretty obvious, doesn't it? It is the ratio of grocery stores to taverns in America by census district. So places that have more taverns than grocery stores get a red dot. Can anybody make out Wisconsin on this map, you know? I saw this map and I thought, yes, this is why we're writing a book on taverns. This is why it's important, because the tavern is a cultural institution in Wisconsin in a way that it is not in other parts of the country. And we want to explore why that is. I lived for a while in Tennessee, in Murfreesboro, Tennessee. And when I moved there, I went to look for a tavern. And the first tavern that we found was a converted fast food restaurant. And you ordered at the fast food counter, and they had the beer menu up on the board, and the stools were bolted to the table and they swung. And I said to my wife, this is wrong. It is wrong. They don't have any idea what a tavern is in Tennessee. So, you know, we all do in Wisconsin, right? We have an idea of what a tavern is. And so what I'm going to talk about today is I'm going to talk about the relationship of taverns to breweries and the historical and cultural aspects of tavern and beer culture in the state. Let's start with why Wisconsin? Why does Wisconsin become a brewing place? There are a number of good reasons for that, but here's some kind of big ideas related to that. First of all, we are an agricultural state, so we have great crop land. And in the early history of brewing, all beer was local, just like it is today. That's what I find so wonderful about the craft beer movement, is we have come full circle again to where beer is local. And so all beer was local. Everybody drank a beer from the place where they lived. Typically, breweries in the early days of Wisconsin would distribute 10 or 15 miles from the brewery. That was their territory. And everything that went into the beer came locally. They grew their own hops. They grew their own barley. All of the ingredients of the beer were local ingredients. And that gave Wisconsin a great advantage, because we had great cropland to be able to grow the barley, grow the hops. And this is this picture over here is hop harvesting. And these are hops growing up these poles. And you notice it's mostly women here harvesting the hops. The hops had to be picked when they were fresh. So as soon as the hop flower ripened, you'd have to pick all the hops. And so all the neighboring farm wives would gather at whatever farm they were growing hops at and just pick all those hops in a day. And then you can see they're all being put in these wooden crates, and they're being shipped off to the breweries. Wisconsin became the largest hop producer in the United States in the 1870s and 1880s. It used to be New York State. There was a hop louse that attacked the hop vines and destroyed the crops. So hop production moved to Wisconsin. There was a huge hop boom here. Hops just exploded because the price was really good on hops. And so many people grew hops that they crashed the price of hops and created a small economic downturn in the Wisconsin economy as a result. In the areas where hops were grown, there were banks that failed as a result of the hops crops price dropping. So once it had recovered again, Wisconsin stopped being the hop producing center, and hop production moved off to Washington State, where Washington State is still the largest hop producer in the United States. But Wisconsin now produces hops again because of that whole local food movement. A lot of the brewers are brewing with local ingredients, and they want Wisconsin-grown hops, so it's now a commodity again. This postcard over here is a postcard from Milwaukee. This is Neptune. I don't know that you realize that Neptune lived in Lake Michigan, but he does. And you can see he's holding a flagon of beer here in his hand, which, you know, if you're Neptune and you're living in Milwaukee, you're going to be drinking beer. And it says here, the caption says, "I'd rather command one glass of beer than all the water on the sphere." Bravo to that, I say. And one of the other things that made Wisconsin a great state for beer was we have very good water here. And believe it or not, beer is mostly water. And so having great pure water was a really important part of brewing because the water imparts a taste to the beer. So brewers are very, very particular about the water that they brew with. And today a lot of the, like if you drink a Bud beer, Bud is Bud is Bud is Bud, and they brew it all over the country, but the Bud all tastes the same because they treat all the water. So they remove all the minerals from the water that would give it a particular taste so that they can have very neutral tasting water and have a Bud that is made in Florida taste like a Bud that's made in Missouri. So, so water is very, very important. You probably noticed as you were on your way here today that, and this may have been a surprise to some of you in the room, but in Wisconsin, it gets so cold that water freezes on the ground. You can even drive on it. And that was a huge advantage in Wisconsin, the fact that we had lots of water here and lots of ice, because ice was incredibly important to brewing in the 19th century before the advent of mechanical refrigeration. Who invented mechanical refrigeration? The breweries did. The breweries did. First mechanical refrigeration, because they used an enormous amount of ice. Milwaukee in the 1880s was consuming 300 million tons of ice a year in the brewing industry. They were the second largest producer of ice, or of consumer of ice. Only the meatpacking industry used more. Because the ice was used for a number of different purposes. They would harvest it from the lakes like this, cut it into blocks, put it in ice houses. And if you're brewing lager beer, the thing about lager beer is the yeast is very temperamental about temperature. It wants to be at 50 degrees. That's why we have beer caves, to keep the beer cool so the lager yeast can do its work. So they would pack the beer caves full of ice, throw sawdust on top of the ice to insulate it, and then when the temperature started rising in the beer cave, they'd just uncover some of the ice and let the ice evaporate into the air, cool it, the temperature back down, and when it got too cold, they'd throw sawdust back on top of the ice again. So they used ice that way, but they also used the ice to keep the beer as well. So once the beer was brewed and it was sitting in kegs in the keg house, they had ice in the keg house. And then once breweries get a little bigger and they become more industrial and you're shipping beer by railroad, they're packing railroad cars full of ice and beer and sending them off. So ice was really important. This is a map of the railroad network of the United States. And one of the things that's really inescapable is all lines converge right here in Chicago. And that made Chicago a really great transshipment point. So why did Chicago not become the beer capital of the, America? Why was it Milwaukee? Well, you probably remember Mrs. O'Leary, and she had a cow that kicked over a lantern and burned down the city of Chicago, burned to the ground. What happened as a result of that is people rushed to Chicago to rebuild Chicago, and those people were mighty thirsty. And Milwaukee brewers saw the opportunity to take that Chicago market, and they shipped down enormous quantities of beer from Milwaukee to Chicago as Chicago is being rebuilt. Anybody tell me the slogan of Schlitz beer? The beer that made Milwaukee famous. Why did it make Milwaukee famous? Because they shipped down free beer to Chicago after the fire. And as a result of that, Schlitz and Pabst became the largest brewers in the world. And they used that rail network to distribute beer. So Pabst had brew pubs coast to coast and shipped beer. By the 1870s, they shipped beer all the way down to Australia. And they shipped a load down. They drank half of it in Australia because they were curious, you know, how's it going to travel? And they pronounced it good. They shipped the other half back to Milwaukee and never said anything about what that beer tasted like. So I'm thinking the beer after the return voyage was not successful. The other thing that Wisconsin has is a lot of drinkers. You know, you can brew all the beer you want, but you got to get somebody to drink it. And Wisconsin, because of the settlement patterns of Wisconsin, Wisconsin was settled by a lot of people who came from beer drinking cultures. The Germans, the Irish, the Poles, who they were beer loving people before they came to Wisconsin. They brought that cultural heritage with them to the state. So all of that conspired to Wisconsin becoming a beer state and, by extension, a tavern state. So what were taverns originally? What did they look like? The territorial laws of Wisconsin from 1838 talk about taverns in the law. They're already regulating taverns. I thought that was fascinating. And this is what they say about taverns. The tavern keeper must be a man of good moral character. Good luck on that one, I think. That was aspirational, perhaps. And the other restrictions were each tavern must have 2 sleeping beds and a provender of hay for the horses. And I'm thinking, 2 sleeping beds is not a bad idea, really, because if we instituted that law again in Wisconsin, it might help with the drunk driving problem, you know. But what that says is that taverns were stagecoach stops in 1838. Taverns were places where people would stay over, so you had to have sleeping beds and you had to have hay for the horses. So these are a couple early taverns from Wisconsin that still survive today. The one in the bottom here, this is the Wade House in Sheboygan. It's owned by the Wisconsin Historical Society. They have restored the tavern room of that inn, and you can see it's not a lot like we think of taverns today. It does have a back bar and a front bar here. You can see there's almost nothing on the back bar. Very stubby little front bar. There's nothing on the back bar because they don't really have a lot to sell. You know, all their liquor, whether it was whiskey, gin, or beer, all came locally, and there was no such thing as a brand. They just served what the local products were. So you didn't need fancy bottles with labels on it because you've only got one choice. And all beer's coming out of a keg, and so is the whiskey and the gin. They just keep kegs in the basement, and they keep refilling the same bottle again and again. This one up here is the Israel Stoll Temperance House in Delavan. The Temperance House has a very interesting history because it was built in a dry community that was a utopianist community. These two brothers, the Phoenix brothers, moved to Delavan from the East Coast. They want to create a dry community. So they buy up 460 acres of land, they plat the city of Delavan, they deed restrict every property in the city with a restriction that says you cannot manufacture, sell, or consume alcohol on any of those properties. And they go to a convention for temperance houses, or a temperance convention, and they learn about temperance houses, and they decide they want to build one of those in their city. And a temperance house is a stagecoach stop that doesn't serve alcohol. And so they give this piece of land to Mr. Child, and they ask him to build a temperance house, and he builds this place that you see in the photo here. And opens up for business, and all those dusty, thirsty Teamsters that are heading through in their wagons, they stop at this place, they find out it's dry, they keep going. It's a dismal, dismal failure. So the Phoenix brothers, one of them dies, the other one decides to move back to New York, And as soon as they leave, Mr. Childs starts serving liquor at the temperance house. So it was only a dry house for a couple of years, and then it becomes a stagecoach tavern like every other, and damned be the deed restrictions on the property. So that's one of the sources that the tavern comes from. Another source of the tavern is the general store. And we're looking at a picture here that's taken somewhere in Wisconsin. We're not sure exactly where that is. And you can see it's a store and saloon here over the door. And under Wisconsin law, stores could have what was called a sample room to sample up to a quart of your favorite beverage. We don't want to be skimpy, right? There was a good reason for that. They allowed people to sample their booze before they bought it because the quality of booze was so unpredictable from batch to batch. Brewing and distilling were really arts more than science. They didn't even know what yeast was. They knew that you had to have yeast in your alcohol to make alcohol, but they had no idea what it was and what it did. They just knew it created magic. And so there was so much inconsistency between the difficulties of controlling temperature with, you know, ice and all of the contamination of yeast with wild strains of yeast that just happened to be in the air, you know, the imprecise manner of brewing meant that batch to batch, it was very different. So the purpose of the sample room was if you're going to buy a keg of whiskey or a barrel of beer, you want to know what that was going to taste like before you bought a whole barrel. So the sample rooms would sit in the back of the store, and this is a sample room from a Wisconsin store. And you can see it's got a very, very short, stubby little bar here, a couple of bottles of booze on the back there. The guys are drinking beer, and they're sampling. And the sample room was very, very successful. And in some stores, they would enlarge the sample room as it had more activity, and it got to the point where the sample room pushed the store out the front door, and it became a saloon. So, you know, that's another origin of taverns. One of the things we don't think about related to taverns is that tavern keeping was a profession much akin to white-collar professions today. It was a very highly coveted position, and tavern owners were very, very influential. One of Wisconsin's early governors was a tavern keeper. Some of the signers of Wisconsin Constitution were tavern keepers. At one point, two-thirds of the alder people in Milwaukee were tavern keepers. Why is that? Well, think about the 19th century and how people learned information. You know, the tavern keepers knew what was going on because they talked to people who came in the bar. So they had their ear to the ground, which made them great politicians. And it also meant that they had a lot of knowledge. Knowledge is power. So the tavern became a centerpiece of the communities and a part of the social fabric of the community. This is a tavern keeper's manual that, thanks to Google Books, they digitized this. Harry Johnson wrote a book that told people how to keep a tavern. It's fascinating reading for a geek like me. And it told you things like how to raise a good bar boy, don't swear in front of your bar boy, because he's going to pick that up. You want him to be a decent person, so don't keep the swearing a minimum. And it told you how to keep the flies out of your booze bottles, you know, because you're filling those in the basement, right? Yep. And a couple of neat illustrations from that are this illustration of the business side of the bar. You know, this is the front bar here. You're on a bar stool back here. You don't see this side here of the bar. And what you can see here are all those refillable booze bottles that they're filling from kegs in the basement, some slop buckets here, almost nothing. You know, there's almost nothing in the bar. And then up on top, you're seeing these kind of glasses and glassware, stemware. One of the things that was surprising for me is that cocktails were not very common in the 19th century. People didn't really drink many cocktails. The first cocktail book ever written had 80-some recipes for cocktails in it, but it had over 200 recipes for alcoholic punches. Most people drank shot and a beer. By people, I mean men, because women did not go in taverns. And so they did make alcoholic punches, and that's what all of this stuff is here. These are punch. These are for making punches. Looking through historic photos of taverns in Wisconsin, you see this image quite commonly from this era. It's a boy drinking a beer. And there was no drinking age in Wisconsin in the 19th century. And there was a good reason for it. And there was a reason why this boy is drinking beer here. He's drinking beer so he won't die. He's drinking beer because beer is safe water. In the 19th century, when water supplies were so unreliable and they carried so much disease, children drank beer for health. And brewers brewed beer for children. It was called table beer. And it was about 2% alcohol. And the reason why they drank beer is because beer, going through the brewing process, it killed off all the bacteria that was in the water and it made the water safe to drink. So that's why you see kids in these photos. The other kind of kid that you might see in a bar is a growler boy. And this is a growler boy who worked at the Tepfer Sons Ironworks. Anybody ever had a growler of beer? Right, yeah. We have growlers yet today. I think it's great that we still call them growlers today. And the reason why they're called growlers is because in the 19th century, beer to go came in a pail. They didn't bottle beer. Bottled beer was very rare and expensive because the bottles had to be all handmade one at a time. So bottles are expensive. So you just went to the tavern with a pail and had them fill your pail with beer, and that was your beer to go. And when you get that pail, you'd put a lid over the top of it to keep the flies out as you're carrying it home. And as you're carrying it home, you're slashing that beer, and that CO2 in the beer is erupting, and it's flapping the lid on the pail, and the pail is growling at you. So that's where the term growler comes from. Yeah, great, huh? So this guy's a growler boy, and he's got all of these pails on this apparatus that he can carry because he's running to the neighborhood bar and getting beer for break time for the workers, and then bringing it back to the factory, and they pay him a couple of cents for making the runs. And so in the 19th century, lots of kids were getting beer for their parents, getting beer for the, you know, as a job in the factory, and some of that beer never made it back to the parents or the factory. It was, you know, you squat down on the edge of the curb and have a little drink. So children and alcohol was an issue in the 19th century that they recognized was an issue, but they didn't really have a good solution to it. So how do we get from taverns that are pretty plain and ordinary places to taverns that have spectacular interiors, that are elaborate, expensive, that are the saloons that we know from the turn of the century? It all boils down to the price of a barrel of beer. In the 1870s, beer starts becoming industrial, and you move away from farm breweries, small breweries, to breweries that are much bigger. And Pabst and Schlitz and Blatt's and Miller lead the way in this explosion of the beer industry as an industry, as an industrial product. You can see it in some really significant changes. Once Louis Pasteur, anybody heard of Louis Pasteur? And why is he known? Pasteurization, right. But the most successful thing that Louis Pasteur did that made him a large fortune was he figured out what yeast was and what it did to beer. And what yeast does is this, and think about this next time you drink a beer. What yeast does is it eats the sugars in the grain and it pees alcohol and farts CO2. And it does that till it drowns in its own pee. And that's where it comes from. So Louis Pasteur figured that out, and he figured out that yeast also have a lot to do with the flavor of the beer as well, and that if you want to be consistent in your beer, you have to be consistent in the way you use your yeast and keep your strain of yeast pure, and you have to invigorate it occasionally with new yeast. And he runs around Europe and he sells that knowledge to brewers, and it changes beer because it makes beer much more reliable, and it means that beer can become more industrial because you can control the product. So Schlitz brings, in about 1880, Schlitz brings a pure strain of yeast from Germany, of lager yeast, to make lager beer. Pabst in that same year hires its first chemist. So it tells you that a revolution is happening. Well, breweries begin to become targets for investment, and there's a lot of British capital that comes into America to fund breweries. Breweries get large, very large, and it means that, I know this is going to be hard to believe, but they produce more beer than they could sell. And it becomes very successful, and it starts driving the price of a barrel of beer down. A barrel of beer was taxed by the federal government. They instituted an excise tax on beer to pay for the Civil War, $3.79 a barrel. And a barrel of beer sold for about $8. All this competition comes in. It drives down the price of a barrel of beer as low as $4. So the breweries are bleeding money, and they can't figure out how to stop because everybody's undercutting everybody else's price. They try to price fix. The Milwaukee, Chicago brewers get together. They sign this pledge in blood that says, oh, we swear we will not sell a barrel of beer for less than $8, and they immediately all violate it. Because the brewery owners, they don't care whose beer they're vending. They care about the cost. The salespeople need to move the product, so they're selling it to get it out of the brewery. And it causes a lot of economic hardship for the brewers. But the one thing that the brewers had was they had capital from all that investment. So they decided the solution was own the taverns. If you buy the taverns, you can control the price of beer. So they bought taverns, built taverns, and leased taverns. And those taverns that were owned by the breweries became known as tide houses. We've all heard that term, tide house. They were called tide houses because they were economically tied to the brewery. And once you get that brewery money in taverns, all of a sudden, the tavern is an extension of the brand of the brewery because the taverns are brand loyal. If you are Wolski's Tavern in Milwaukee, which this is a picture of, and you sign a contract with Pabst, which Bernard Wolski did, to sell only Pabst products, this becomes Pabst brand. And Pabst is concerned about the image of the brand, so that breweries are willing to invest a lot of money in taverns and pay for elaborate fixtures. And this is a picture of a back bar out of the Brunswick Bulky and Colander catalog, and it's called the Lucky Baldwin, and that's that same back bar here at Wolski's. So Wolski's gets a free back bar, front bar, tables, glasses, signs, all of the bling that imposes that Pabst brand on this tavern. So as a result of that, taverns become a lot more elaborate. And even these kind of mom-and-pop taverns can have these very, very fancy front bars and back bars, and they become an extension of that brewery brand. By the way, the Brunswick Balkan Colander Company, they become the largest producer of back bars in the United States. They start out as a maker of pool tables because pool had become a fad, and they realized they can sell more pool tables if they sell the entire package for taverns, so they start getting into the back bar business and become incredibly successful. I had the good fortune of finding a bunch of these Brunswick Balkan Colander catalogs, and as we were driving around Wisconsin doing our research and visiting these taverns, we got to the point where we could recognize the Brunswick Balkan Colander taverns by back bars by sight. Ah, Hurley. a woman in the audience, Sue Landretti, brought some bling here from Hurley. This is her grandfather's tavern license from the 19-teens, and a picture of the grandfather's tavern, which was located on Silver Street in Hurley. And one of the fascinating things about going around talking about taverns is inevitably somebody asks the question of, is it true that fill in the blank for the name of the community has more taverns per capita than any other place in Wisconsin? And I get that comment really often. And the answer is no, unless it's Hurley. Because I have a friend who did some research on Hurley, and he discovered that at the turn of the century, Hurley had 54 taverns in one single city block. It had basement, first story, and second story taverns. And the reason why it had so many taverns is miners and loggers would take the train cars into Hurley with their paychecks and leave without them. And so Hurley had a reputation for being a surly place, or surly Hurley. And a little event happens in the history of America called Prohibition, which if you know anything about Prohibition, you know that it was incredibly successful. Right? Incredibly successful. It did two things really well, though. It created organized crime, and it made common people criminals. That it did very successfully. What it didn't do is stop people from drinking, especially in Wisconsin. And in Hurley, the federal prohibition agents mount a raid in Hurley in 1928. And you can see from that newspaper headline that they padlock shut 29 taverns in the city that day. Busted, padlocked the doors. They ran out of padlocks, and they had to go to Ironwood and buy more padlocks because they were so successful. And they arrested one out of every 10 adult males. 10% of the male population went to jail for violating prohibition in a single day in Hurley. They all had to go to the courthouse and pay their fines, and they just lined them up in a line at the judge, in front of the judge's podium, and they would just come up, plead guilty, put their money on the table, turn, the next one would come up, plead guilty, put their money on the table. And it just shows you what a terrible problem prohibition was. There were good reasons why prohibition existed. It existed because there were tremendous problems with alcohol abuse. People drank about three times as much as people drink today. Men drank at work, before work, during their breaks, after work. There were no homeless shelters. There were no battered women's shelters. Men would go off, spend the family paycheck, come home penniless to starving wife and children, and there was no help in sight. So the churches organized against this tremendous abuse of alcohol, and Prohibition was passed and put into law as the solution. Well, it obviously wasn't a solution because it wouldn't work, and there were so many reasons why Prohibition failed. But during Prohibition, it was catastrophic for the brewers. You know, brewing was the fifth largest industry in Milwaukee before Prohibition. They shut down the fifth largest industry in the city overnight. And imagine the economic collateral effect that had in the city. It was awful. So brewers tried a lot of different things. Pabst made cheese. Schlitz made candy bars and chewing gum. And a lot of brewers brewed temperance beer, near beer, we call it. This is from a Black River Falls brewer, and it's just beer that has had the alcohol taken out of it. So it's non-alcoholic beer. And it was never successful. It was just never successful. The tavern owners also struggled with what to do. Many taverns became restaurants. There's an explosion, you know, the restaurant culture as we know it today is a product of Prohibition because people didn't eat out that much before Prohibition, but once all of these surplus saloons are just sitting around, many of them become restaurants. And you can see this as an old saloon because here's the back bar, there's the front bar there. Put some tables and chairs in and open it up as the Diamond Buffet. Now, many of these were also speakeasies as well. And it was incredibly difficult to enforce the law. One of the huge problems with enforcing Prohibition is you could raid a tavern, but you could not search an individual person unless you had a search warrant for that person. So taverns simply would sew pockets into the servers' uniforms and put the booze right in their pockets, and then you know the agents would come in and. You know, no booze here, and move on. So there were lots of issues with that. One of the major loopholes of Prohibition was that it was legal to purchase alcohol with a prescription from your doctor. Think about that, huh? There were a lot of people with a lot of ailments during Prohibition that could be treated with alcohol. And this is a tavern that we included in the book in Oshkosh. And when I walked into this place, I saw this front bar and I thought, huh, look at that. I've never seen a tiled front bar before. And I'm looking at it, I'm thinking, that looks almost like a soda fountain to me. I wonder if this thing was a pharmacy. Yes. Was a pharmacy during Prohibition. They took the tavern and turned it into a pharmacy, and he bought a license for $5 to open a pharmacy, and he dispensed whiskey and beer by prescription. This place over here, this is Nelson's Hall. This is on Washington Island off the tip of Door County, and Tom Nelson believed in the medicinal qualities of bitters. Bitters was considered to be medicinal because it calmed your stomach. And so Tom drank a pint of bitters a day. And he lived to be 94 years old. So something was working for Tom there. So when Prohibition ended, he continued to sell bitters across the bar because bitters was exempt from Prohibition. Bitters is 90 proof. And so he also bought a pharmacy license, paid his $5, and so he opened, he reopened his bar as a pharmacy during Prohibition. And today you can still get a shot of bitters at Nelson's Hall, and they are the largest consumer of bitters in the world. They sell 10,000 shots of bitters a year. They're certified by the Guinness Book of World Records. So Prohibition fails for so many reasons. And here's an interesting little fact. Wisconsin's governor, John Blaine, signed the Wisconsin Prohibition law into effect, at the beginning of Prohibition. There was the federal Prohibition law, but the state passed one too that authorized state and local law enforcement officers to arrest people for violating Prohibition. It was called the Severson Act. Governor John Blaine signed that law into effect. Blaine goes on to be a U.S. Senator, and he authors the bill to appeal the 19th Amendment, what becomes the 21st Amendment. So he signs Prohibition into effect in Wisconsin. A decade later, he drafts the law to rescind Prohibition. And there were a lot of people who second-guessed the wisdom of Prohibition with all of the problems that it brought and its ineffectiveness. And so a campaign is mounted, which, interestingly enough, is again driven by women, and Prohibition is repealed. When Prohibition is repealed in Wisconsin, there are some really pronounced effects as a result of that, that change the tavern. And one of the things that changed is in 1933, they repealed Prohibition, just for beer. The next year, they passed a separate law that repeals it for spirits. And the tavern changes because in the 19th century, up to Prohibition, only men went to taverns. Taverns were not for women. If you were standing at a bar and you were a woman before Prohibition, you're a prostitute, because many taverns were also brothels, and that's where the ladies of the evening met their clients. So self-respecting women didn't go in taverns unless they had a ladies' parlor, which was attached to the back of the tavern space, and then women and children could go in that space, but they could not go in the tavern. And the servers would come out and serve them in that space. So taverns were man spaces, and that's why we didn't have bar stools in taverns, because men preferred to stand. It was considered to be good for the digestion of your alcohol to be standing while you were drinking. And it probably helped with over-serving, too, I'm guessing, because that would be kind of self-moderating, right? So during Prohibition, one of the huge cultural changes is women start going to speakeasies. Why? There's no law. They're lawless. There's no opening hours. There's no closing hours. There's no drinking age. There's no over-serving. And women are welcome. And they play that crazy jazz music. And these young flappers who are trying to separate themselves from the Victorian shackles of their mothers bob their hair, start smoking cigarettes, wear slinky dresses, dance the Charleston. They're leaving the good life in those speakeasies. And when the speakeasies end and the taverns come, women come into the tavern. And taverns become gender-neutral spaces. And it changes the way that the taverns are. One of the changes is that bars begin to curve, because all of a sudden we have bar stools. Women didn't want to stand at the bar. They wanted to sit. So if you're all sitting in a row at a saloon, it's very difficult to talk to each other. But if you curve that bar, it improves the conversation. Taverns are social spaces. So we get that curving happening. We also get cocktail booths, because cocktail culture is born in the tavern and then moves out, or in the speakeasy, and moves out to the tavern, and they have to create special spaces for the consumption of cocktails by couples. So a couple seating here. This is the Casino Tavern in La Crosse, one of my favorite taverns in the state. Its motto since it opened was lousy service, and you can see it's lousy service neon sign here. There it is on the ad, on the early opening ad. You know, I think what's really great about this picture is you can see this image all the time in newspapers. When a new tavern opens, they take an image of the bartenders behind the bar. In this case, they're all sleeping. It says sleeping left to right with their names. And the casino has always had a great sense of humor. One of the really wonderful things about the casino is they would run these really funny ads in the newspaper. My favorite one was during the depths of the Depression. They ran an ad with a picture of this ramshackle house, and it said, "Why pay your mortgage when you can spend your money at the casino?" The direct appeal. This is Brian's Cocktail Lounge in Milwaukee. This was the first cocktail lounge in the city of Milwaukee, established in 1937. And as a result of Prohibition, bartenders become mixologists, and the cocktail is born as culture. And part of the origin of the cocktails, women come into the speakeasies and they don't want to drink shot in a beer like their boyfriends or husbands. They want something that's more palatable, and the booze is terrible because it's all rot gut, bathtub gin, bootleg whiskey. And so you can mix it with other things to disguise the taste of it and make it more palatable. And the person, Randy Bryant, who established the Bryant's Cocktail Lounge, was a mixologist who invented over 460 cocktails. If you go in there today, you sit down at the bar there, and they don't have a cocktail menu. They interview you. They say, "Well, what kind of liquor do you prefer? And do you like sweet? Do you like sour?" They ask you a few questions, and then they make a cocktail for you. And it's a great, great experience. And he's most famous for inventing the pink squirrel. Anybody had a pink squirrel? Yeah, great supper club drink. So one of the things that really changes the tavern is the popularity of the automobile, especially after World War II. As we move out to the suburbs after World War II become single-use zoned, so you cannot have a tavern in the middle of a subdivision. Taverns are isolated, and they're put out on the edge of town on the gasoline alley and on the commercial strips. It means everybody drives to get to the tavern, and it creates that little problem that we still wrestle with today called drunk driving. And so once people start driving to taverns, it means that taverns have to compete with other taverns for customers in a way they didn't before. And before, they served a neighborhood. Now that they serve a clientele. And it means that taverns become more demographically discriminating, and they start looking for specific clienteles, and taverns take on personas or themes that separate them. This is an early example from Milwaukee called the Safe House. Anybody been to the Safe House? Yeah, look at all these people who've been to the Safe House. Don't say the password. It's an espionage-themed bar that was created because of the popularity of all of the spy movies from the Cold War. Man from U.N.C.L.E., James Bond, Get Smart, all of that stuff. And the rooms of the bar are themed according to various kind of spy stories. And so taverns start becoming a lot more like that. And taverns end up becoming destinations. This is the bunker, the DMZ bunker in Waterford, and it's a military-themed tavern started by some Vietnam vets, filled inside and out with military memorabilia. Sometimes the trip is half of the joy. These are two great destination taverns in Wisconsin. The one on the left-hand side is Tom's Burnt Down Cafe. Who's been there? Yeah, now that is an experience. It's an experience. Here's the really quick story of that place. Tom buys a tavern called Leona's Cafe, puts it on logs, and rolls it across the island closer to the ferry stop and starts working on it. It catches on fire and burns down. The only thing that's left is the deck. So the next day, he's sifting through the ashes, and his beer delivery truck pulls up. And he's like, "Oh crap, what do I do with this?" So he just put the beer in the trunk of his car, and he set up some folding chairs on the deck, and he started serving on the deck. And it hasn't changed, really. The car is still there. It's actually under the deck. They built, as it became more popular and he needed more space, he just expanded the deck and he built it right over the top of the car. So if you know where to look, you can see Tom's car under the deck boards. And, it it's gotten all fancy now, and they hang up a circus tent here over the top of it in the summer. And they have all of these great signs everywhere. This is my favorite one, for sale by neighbor. It's on Madeline Island. For sale by neighbor. Yeah, my other favorite one is just as you walk out here, as you're walking down these steps, there's a little sign that says, "Last one out, turn off Tom." And if you've ever met Tom, you'll know how true that is. This is in Menkelville, which is over in Kewaunee County, and it was a neighborhood tavern in a very, very small town. There were like three blocks in this whole town, a couple hundred people. And the grandparents closed the bar, and the kids didn't want to take it over, so it just sat there vacant. And the grandkids said, you know, let's open that place back up. So they remodeled it, and they turned it into a biker bar called the Iron Horse. And it's super popular among bikers because you ride through the Kettle Moraine to get to it. It's a beautiful, beautiful ride to get up there. So the ride is half of the attraction. And if you go on a Saturday or Sunday, there are hundreds of bikes lined up along the street. There's hundreds of them. It's very, very popular. So in the case of these places, it's the trip that makes the experience. Okay, oops, shameless promotion. Yeah, we brought some books along. Yankees Bookstore is selling them. I'd be happy to sign a book if you're interested in it. Yada, yada. We also did a documentary for Wisconsin Public Television, which you can stream off of their website, or if you're a regular viewer, you're going to see it again and again and again. The producer of that said, Jim, you'll be forever middle-aged, because we'll be showing this documentary for the next 10 years, I can guarantee it. All right. So that's my admonition to all of you. Somebody asked in the very beginning if there are handouts. I don't have any handouts, but they're handing out this afternoon samples of Bull Falls beer, which seems like a lot better kind of handout. So with that, I think we have time for a couple
of
questions?
We do. We have time for four questions. I want a round of applause for our presenter. Thank you.
Sure.
I do need to clarify that the sampling will not be a quart, as it was mentioned previously.
Right.
So sorry. Four questions.
Hi, my grandfather ran Weinkauf's Tavern and Cafe here in town. And one of the things I always wondered was, I moved out to California and I took the Corbel Champagne Tour up in the Russian River.
Yeah.
And they asked the audience, they said, is anybody from Wisconsin? Because we'd like to thank you, because about 90% of our brandy is sent to your state.
True.
And my grandfather, which I had to help with when I was younger, brandy and beer. Why did so much brandy and the combination, how did that happen in Wisconsin?
That's a great story. I wrote about that in a sidebar in the book, because I thought, that's such a characteristic Wisconsin thing. Where's that come from? Well, here's the really short story of it. Brandy is produced from grapes. And brandy was mainly produced in France, and it was imported to America. And you probably have all are aware that there was a great grape blight that occurred in France that damaged all of the grape stock in the country. And French grapes are grown in American grape stock now, and the root stock is from American grapes because they were resistant to this blight. And it meant that brandy production just fell apart. It just pretty much disappeared. Well, California is growing grapes, and the Corbel brothers decide that they're going to get into the brandy business, and they start making brandy, and they can't sell it for anything. They just can't get a foothold in the market for it. So in 1893, they come to the Chicago World's Fair and they set up a very fancy booth. They invest a lot of money and start selling brandy at the Chicago World's Fair. And since Chicago is so close to Wisconsin, a lot of Wisconsin people went to the fair, and Germans found that they liked that sweetness of brandy. They liked that they were attracted by the sweetness of the taste of brandy. And so they brought that fascination for brandy back from the Chicago World's Fair into Wisconsin. And Wisconsin today is the largest brandy consumer in the United States. And if you go to other parts of the country and you ask for brandy, they will ask you if you're from Wisconsin. They'll say, how is the weather in Wisconsin? Especially if you order a brandy old fashioned. They're like, how is the weather in Wisconsin these days?
Is the Anchor Bar and Grill, which is in Superior, in your book?
No, the Anchor is not in the book. I visited the Anchor when I was doing my research. We visited about 460 taverns to figure out the 55 taverns that we included in the book. We were looking for places that were represented all the eras and phases of the tavern business in the state, that represented, that were authentic to whatever they were, and were really worth going to. The question I would ask my co-author Mark all the time was, would you travel an hour and a half to come to this tavern? And if you did, would you be disappointed? Or would you think, wow, that was really worth the trip? And if it was worth the trip, then we would include it in the book. So we had to make a lot of hard choices. It was kind of like, if you've seen the movie Sophie's Choice, she has to determine which child she loves the most and is going to save. And that was kind of it for us. It was really painful in some places to decide, which child we love the most and we're going to put in the book.
Okay, go ahead. I was a band director in Hurley from 1954 or something until the early 60s. And I was walking down the street one day, and Silver Street, and a guy came along, said, where can you get a drink around here? And I'd like to point out that...
He wasn't from town, I'm thinking.
No, he wasn't. And I'd like to point out that the Wade House is in Greenbush.
Yes. Yeah, Greenbush is halfway between Fond du Lac and Sheboygan, roughly. Yeah, let me just tell you a funny little Hurley story that relates to the other book that I wrote, Filler Up. I gave a presentation to a Lutheran men's fellowship in Madison, and a guy came up afterwards and he said, I have a story for you. I didn't want to tell it in front of everybody else. I said, okay, great. And he said, I used to organize these youth trips for the church, and we'd go up to northern Wisconsin skiing. And we had planned a trip up to Hurley, and we got there, and there was a screw-up on the reservations, and they had double-booked, and they didn't have rooms for the kids. So he said they were very, very helpful and really accommodating, trying to find somewhere for the kids to stay. And the girls all went out to a farmhouse outside of town, and the boys went to an old gas station. And he said, we got inside of the gas station, and they had put walls up in the gas station. They had created these tiny little rooms, each of which was just the size of for a bed. And the walls only went up 8 feet tall. And he said, I told the boys, you can never tell your parents ever where you stayed here. Because he said, I realized it was a brothel. We were keeping the boys in a brothel. And that was about 30 years before I gave that talk, and he was still too embarrassed by it to say it out loud in front of the other men.
I have two questions, and you can answer either or both.
Okay.
One is Limburger cheese and its association with bars, and does it really work? I mean, is it... any good together?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. And the other one is, what's your favorite bar in Marathon County?
In Marathon County, oh, gosh. All right, let's take the Limburger one first. I think you have to drink booze if you're going to eat Limburger. You know, you just got to do it to build up some liquid courage in order to try a Limburger. Because if you haven't tried Limburger, it's like eating smelly gym socks. I mean, it has an odor about it that is rather off-putting for most people. And so I think it's courage. It just takes a lot of courage to try your first bite of Limburger.
My father always talked about Limburger cheese, but I noticed that I never, ever smelled it in the house.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, there
was actually, at one time, it was forbidden to mail Limburger in the mail because of the smell associated with it. My favorite bar in Marathon County, oh boy, that's a tough one. I'm going to give a kind of curious answer here. I think it's the Pollock Inn. Even though I have never been in the Pollock Inn, I have tried for about 5 years now to go to the Pollock Inn, and it is never open when I get to Wausau. It's never open. I went last night, and it was closed. I'm like, no, not again, not again. I peeked through the window many times, and it's just, you know, it looks wonderful. It looks like really a neat place, you know, pressed metal ceilings and walls. It's got a lot of character to it. But I think it's operated by characters too, because it appears to never be open, or at least the word gets out that Draeger's coming to town. You better close the doors. Open for lunch, great. I know what I'm doing for lunch today.
Yes. Thank you, Jim, so much. It was a pleasure. Thank you so much.